really like every dollar in your P&L and your profit is going to be worth 4, 5, 6 at exit. So this type of long-term planning can really help.
Any acquirers right now are purchasing business, they really go like deeper or just expand these businesses.
30 or 40 groups that have raised millions of dollars, if not hundreds of millions of dollars, with the sole purpose of buying FBA-based businesses.
Welcome to Dr. Amazon Podcast, the emergency support channel for FBA private label sellers. We invite top Amazon experts to share the most efficient tips and tricks for your businesses. My name is Vitaly Hizhniak and I am the CGO of Profit Whales. And let's get started.
Great time when you decide to sell your Amazon business and take some time to relax. By the way, we have already talked with the acquirers of Amazon businesses. But how to prepare for the exit? We discuss problems that arise during the exit process and how to avoid them with the Jack Barnett, VP Business Development at Fortinet. Welcome back to another episode of the Dr. Amazon Podcast. I'm super excited about the content, the topic, and the guest that we have for today. It is Jake Barnett, Vice President and Business Development at Fortinet. Jake, nice to meet you.
Yeah, likewise. Thanks for having me. Great to be on.
So I know that you have a lot of experience in a case of like the business acquisition inside the Amazon, and you try like both of these sites, but I would like to know more about the story. Could you please tell me more about like, how did you get into the e-commerce? Then how did you just try these both sites? Yeah, because it's like super cool experiences I get.
Yeah, thanks. Interesting kind of like, I guess, journey, I think, a little different than most of the sellers, what they how they got into the space. I had previously worked more in software and tech and digital marketing, done this kind of digital nomad thing for about 10 years. Along the way, I met a lot of really successful Amazon sellers, folks living in, you know, Thailand or Medellin or wherever. So I was always kind of exposed to the Amazon ecosystem through that and met some really successful people, loved what they were doing. My work in tech, I had actually done a lot selling software to e-commerce and retail. So I was kind of familiar with it from those both sides. I was living in the Philippines a couple of years ago. I met an aggregator, one of the early acquirers of Amazon businesses there. Just love the idea, love the obviously trends of the Amazon space, and just thought, you know, my combination of experience on the tech side and customer acquisition could work well with the aggregators. So I joined one of those, and then I met another one, which is kind of a large and early acquirer of Amazon businesses. Joined them working in business development, basically going out trying to find acquisitions. So I did about 15 acquisitions on the buy side with a couple aggregators, spoke with probably 500 plus sellers in the last 2 years, got to learn a lot from their side. And, about 2 months ago, I decided to join Fortinet, met them as a buyer, looking at their deals, was always super impressed with the team, the professionalism, how tough negotiators they are. And I just like the idea of kind of switching over to the sell side, taking what I learned as a buyer, some of the kind of tricks of the trade, and using that to basically help sellers maximize their outcomes. I like working with sellers. You know, I love the community. I love the hustle and the grit that these sellers have. So, you know, switch teams kind of, and now working with Fortinet to, you know, help these businesses both prepare for sale and then execute on the transaction and go through the entire process. So it's kind of what led me to where I am today.
That is great because, you know, I guess you have right now joined the Fortinet in a great, like hot time in the case of the acquisition market. Could you please tell us more about why we have like this situation in this market? In the case of that, we got a lot of companies that right now interested in FBA businesses. They purchase a lot. And I guess by the end of like 2020, yeah, we just got like this hot and fast period for this niche. Why did that happen?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, it's crazy looking back 2 years ago when I first got into it. there was something like three acquirers out there then. One of them probably everybody's heard of that's now a unicorn and worth billions. Another one was one I was working for, which is growing kind of slow and steady, doing very well. And then one went out of business. So you compare that to today, which now there's something like, I don't know, 30 or 40 groups that have raised millions of dollars, if not hundreds of millions of dollars, with the sole purpose of buying FBA-based businesses. So the market's taken off. There's something like $3 billion in capital that has been invested in these acquirers just to go out and buy FBA businesses. I think the main reasons, you know, that those acquirers are interested are the same reasons that sellers are in the market, is because, you know, this is where the future is. It's not only great now, but everybody sees Amazon and, of course, e-commerce, but Amazon is leading e-commerce as the future. Coronavirus just fast forwarded that by 10 years. So I think that's a main reason. I think also acquirers look at kind of the profile of a typical seller, small business person, a lot of family teams, husband, wives, father, son, people that are really good at launching products and building brands from zero to, you know, a million or plus. Yeah. There's a lot of those. But I think when you see businesses are reaching $1, $5, $10 million, it's a little different for each one. But you see kind of a new set of challenges and expertise and things like capital requirements that are different than what was needed for that first stage. So I think the aggregators see value in being able to take those brands on and bring them into their kind of next stage of their life as a brand. I think originally a lot of the acquirers were just interested in good deals. You know, the multiples 2 years ago were a lot different than they are today. So I think at first it was more just financial, finding a good deal. Yeah. But now I think it's really more about identifying brands with a ton of growth opportunities on Amazon, internationally, DTC, and beyond. And that's really, I think, what's driving the really immense interest in the space.
Yeah, I agree with that, because as I have mentioned, when the any acquirers right now purchase a business, they really go like deeper or just expand these businesses for another markets, for another marketplaces. They launch like a website or social media, like all kind of the marketing campaigns that they could have for expanding and building exactly the brand. So not only the Amazon. And if when we speak about the like the FBA business, it's some kind of like the seed that you have from the beginning.
Yeah.
And it's like, that doesn't matter how much is like the valuation for this business in like for today, for example, because they think about like the next year, 5 years, something like that. In the case of the brand, could they build something or not? Yeah, great. And let's speak more about like who right now buys Amazon businesses. I mean that what is these companies? Who is the buyers and who's interested? Yeah, in that, because what is these big guys that do all these purchases?
Yeah, for sure. You have a lot of the what are known as the aggregators or just FBA roll up folks. You know, the sellers that I talk to every day, you know, are kind of getting hit up by these people a lot. And they're kind of like, I think, becoming well-known in the industry. People understand the model. They're looking for, you know, brands that have great reviews, great rankings, a defensible position. These are folks that are focused more on a horizontal approach, maybe not vertical specific or category specific. So those, there's plenty of options. There's 30 plus of those now. If you're looking to sell your business, you know, there's a lot of options there in terms of potential buyers. You know, again, those folks have raised something like $3 billion collectively. I think there's different types of buyers within that group, but they all kind of have the same model. Find that digital real estate with a good review moat and try and take advantage of those. There are other types of buyers that are increasingly getting more interested in FBA-based businesses, you know, Amazon native. So it doesn't have to be 100% FBA. But folks that kind of started there using it for the majority of their sales. You have folks like private equity that are getting more involved. These folks generally want to kind of get a little bit bigger deals. You know, probably can talk more about that, but they're trying to get a little more bang for their buck. So they might focus on a brand that's maybe eight figures, all kind of depends. Those are actually kind of the small private equity deals. So that might be a boutique private equity that's looking to get involved. There's family offices, which are kind of similar, that are looking to get involved as well. You have other folks that are like strategic or corporate buyers. You know, a lot of times you see people who maybe are distributors or manufacturers of a product, or they have a substantial presence in brick and mortar, and they're looking to expand on Amazon and e-commerce. So, you know, some of the other non-typical buyers that are a little less, you know, the sellers are a little less familiar with, can actually be great options if you can find the right fit, because those folks, a lot of times, they have different synergies that can let them pay more for a business. So yeah, just kind of a few different
and
types.
I guess here we have like a logical like next question about how to choose the right buyer for you. Yeah, because we have a lot of opportunities. You got a lot of companies that right now do that, but how to choose the right fit for you?
Yeah, sure. You know, obviously, I think the deal has a lot to do with it. So, you know, the valuation as well as the structure, the terms. Are you open to things like an earnout or seller financing? So I think that's, for most people, that's probably the primary concern, and that makes sense. But at the same time, you know, these are businesses that people have invested years of their lives. They've sweat, they have tears, sometimes blood, that they've put into building the business. So I don't think anybody wants, even for the best deal, I don't think they want it to go to somebody that they don't have confidence that they can continue to grow it. They want to see their baby, even if they're 100% exit, they want to see their baby continue to succeed, maybe see those products in, you know, Walmart or wherever, some retail someday. So I do think, you know, the first thing is going to be, of course, financial and the deal and the terms. But, you know, I think that finding somebody that maybe has experience in your category or has other synergies beyond just being an FBA, you know, owning a lot of FBA brands. You know, if you are concerned about the future of your brand when it goes beyond your hands, those are things that I would look at. You know, what's the experience? What's the value add they can bring? Especially since there's a lot of earnouts involved. And, you know, I know sellers are really wary of that. So if an earnout is going to be part of the deal, you know, you want your brand to succeed so that you can also see that upside. So I think experience in the category, you know, strong operations on Amazon and off. And then other outside synergies, you know, folks that maybe have like content sites that in your niche that can drive traffic to your listings, stuff that sellers would love to do that don't have the kind of resources or capacity.
Yeah, that is really cool, because I know that a lot of Amazon sellers, they try to like continue and following the business, how the business is growing, what changes they just have. And they every time, like, they do not have any accesses or something like that, but they still check how like the bread, the sales go like up and down and all this stuff. We have such clients, and that is so cool, because right, they have like a half in the year, they just have already like sell their business, and they come back and they like, we still could speak about the products or something like that. And that is really cool to know. Okay, and perfect. But how to prepare, for example, your business and maximize the outcomes during the business sales process?
Yeah, sure. There's a lot of things that you can do 6, 12, 18 months ahead of selling the business. So I think when people think about selling the business, they just jump straight into, you know, the P&L and the accounting and, you know, okay, that's what you need to do to actually sell it. But I look at it more like, what are some things you can do 6 to 18 months in advance to increase the intrinsic value of your business, so that when you do go to sell it, you'll be able to get a higher valuation, right? That's what Fortunet really focuses a lot on. We help people actually execute a transaction, do the P&L, market it to buyers, highly competitive auction, all of that. But, you know, some of the real value add, I believe, is before the sale. So, you know, we have situations where, for example, you know, one client had multiple brands. They were looking to sell one of them. They had nine employees over three different brands. They weren't allocating expenses correctly. And by doing it in advance, 12 months ahead of time, they were able to only put two to the business, and they saved $200,000 in expenses, which at an exit at nearly 5x multiple, that translated to $1 million of extra valuation. So that's one example. Yeah. So really, like, every dollar in your P&L and your profit is going to be worth 4, 5, 6 at exit. So this type of long-term planning can really help.
So
other stuff like,
yeah,
sure. Go ahead.
Yeah. I mean that from these sides, you start from like the auditing, the exactly account or the situation and preparing these brands from the P&L, what exactly could be optimized as a process, like as a business process. And then that will give the valuation in the future. Yeah. When they will understand that they are ready to like purchase, for example. Yeah.
Exactly. It could be employee expenses. It can be things like PPC, you know. A lot of businesses, a lot of folks are running their business for, you know, trying to grow it, but then it's like the same thing as a life cycle of a product launch.
Yeah.
At some point you want to try and increase profitability because of the multiple. So there are things that, you know, almost always when we look at a P&L, we can identify some improvement areas. Some folks are, you know, perfect, but in that regard. And then we also look at other things like IP, trademarks, patents. I've seen deals fall apart because trademarks weren't registered correctly. Patents can really add a lot of value to a business. Sellers love that, or I'm sorry, buyers love that. Yeah. So there's different things that we look at ahead of time that you want to kind of get locked down, so that when you do go to sell, you can really max out. And you know, I think when you look at selling your business, especially the working capital that you have to put in to grow it, you know, you're probably getting 50% or more of the actual take-home profits when you sell your business from the entire life of actually running it. You know, a lot of folks are making hundreds of thousands or millions on paper running their business, but that goes back to, you know, inventory, that goes to taxes. These things are, you know, fast-growing FBA businesses are beasts.
You leave just in cash flow, like every time.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is true. And I know that right now we help Amazon businesses to get prepared for the this like auditing with the help of these like acquirers and the improving the PPC or launching the PPC or finding the new ways on spending more that also could work for you, like on increasing your valuation. And that is a really cool idea for most of the, I guess, Amazon sellers, like 7, 8 figures. They're really interested in finding new spaces on investing more, on spending more, and getting more value for that. So yeah, that is perfect. I would be glad maybe to know more like cases. What do you exactly do, for example? Do you help Amazon businesses, for example, to when you do like this audit and P&L, to provide with any recommendations on launching, for example, a website or some to do some marketing? Is it also a case that could help you to build like to improve your, to maximize your valuation?
Yeah, that's really specific, I think, on the individual business. What we, our kind of general theme around recommendations is we tell people, you know, stick with what you're good at and also stick with what's working. So if you have, if you say, hey, I want to sell my business in 12 months, it might not be the best time to start launching an entirely different and new website and direct to consumer strategy. That takes years to build up. You know, that SEO, email lists, all those things, that can take a long time. So, you know, and that's just kind of like you as an FBA owner, you have a million different things you could do. So we always kind of start with saying, hey, stick with what you're good at. You know, maybe you're killing it in the US and you haven't moved over to the EU yet. That could be a good one. If Amazon's working great for you, that's kind of what we recommend. There's also things we say like, okay, you know, continue with your product pipeline and launching new products and all of those things. But you know, maybe you shift more to, you know, trying to grow existing products rather than launching a ton of new ones, because it's going to take time for that to the full potential to really be reflected in your P&L. So it kind of depends on the profile of the business, but we're really believers in do what you're good at, continue on with that, and then let's optimize it and make sure that it's at the right stage when you do look to sell it. So profits are maximized. You know,
Perfect. Yeah. And how do like these transfer the Amazon business just happens to another person? I mean, how to do it correctly, or what is this process? How it looks like?
Yeah, sure. I think that you know, it's important to go through, first of all, like diligence and, mm-hmm. you know, I've done a lot of diligence and deals at this point. And, you know, I think that having someone like Fortunet, I'm biased, of course, I work for Fortunet, but having someone, a professional on your yeah. team who can guide you through guidance and through diligence and also through deal structures and so forth. So first of all, make sure you have a good deal in place that protects you as a seller. In terms of the actual transfer of the business, it's fairly straightforward. Most of these are done as asset transfers. So you're not necessarily selling your corporate entity, whether it's an LLC in the US or whatever. You're just transferring the assets. One of those is the Seller Central account. Mm-hmm. You know, that's pretty straightforward. That just takes a few days. You transfer the IP, patents, any mm-hmm. trademarks, whatever. So that stuff actually is pretty straightforward. It takes a few days. You know, you have situations where maybe it's a shared Seller Central account and you need to do a listing transfer. That's more complicated, might mm-hmm. take more time, probably buyers less interested in that. But in terms of the actual transfer of the listing, it's pretty easy. You know, you usually want to have escrow in place before you don't want to transfer it over maybe before you get escrow or before you get payment, mm-hmm. those types of things that, you know, where you have a professionally fortunate and or your own attorney advising you, make sure that you're protected as you go through it.
Got it. And what is the last, what is the end, yeah, of this purchase system? I mean, the purchase process, yeah? Do we need any, as the Amazon seller, do we need any post-check after we just finish all this stuff with the selling the business? What is the process about that?
Yeah, sure. Most buyers are going to look for some kind of transition period. For you as the owner, even if it's kind of the standard FBA business, there are still going to be some nuances, some ins and outs of each business. And the buyers want to make sure that they have continuity, that it's a smooth yeah. process. So you're typically looking at least 1-3 months of a transition process as a mm-hmm. seller. That might start at kind of a full time for a month and then taper off 10-20 hours, you know, for the next couple of months. There are other buyers that are looking to leverage the expertise of the owner and maybe mm-hmm. want somebody to stay on 6-12 months in a consulting capacity or mm-hmm. running the entire business. There's a lot of new buyers that maybe don't have as much operational expertise on Amazon and maybe they value that. And that can also lead to perhaps a more of an opportunity as a seller to get more money. Mm-hmm. So there's those situations too. But it's usually, I think the standard one is pretty straightforward. You have a transition period. Maybe you have an earnout involved. So you want to, you know, the reason that buyers want that, at least part of it, is to keep you aligned and to keep you motivated. Mm-hmm. So maybe the consulting and the transition's over, but in 6 months they have an issue and they want to call you and they want you to be motivated to take the call so that you can resolve an issue so that you can hit your earnout. So yeah, you know, those are, and I think it's good to have a relationship. Yeah. I think chemistry is exactly. important for a buyer. You want to make sure it's somebody that you like working with, you like talking to, because stuff is going to come up. And whether you have an earnout or not, you probably, you know, mm-hmm. are willing to help
yeah.
If somebody just purchased your business.
Exactly. And from this point, which problems often arise on the exit period?
Sure. I think a big one is with the P&L and discrepancies that might
exist. In analysis,
exist.
You mean? Like checking the all numbers that we have inside the Amazon? Yeah, was
yeah,
it auditing?
Uh-huh. Yeah, exactly. So when you do when buyers go through diligence, it's mostly, you know, or maybe the biggest focus is P&L and finances. Mm-hmm. I've seen situations where, you know, the P&L that you made an offer on is different from what happens when you go and do diligence. There can be things that, you know, maybe you didn't account for all of advertising expenses and it doesn't have to be on purpose. Things happen because mm-hmm. you know, ad expenses can be complicated, yeah. whether it's credit card or whatever. There's other situations where maybe the cost of goods has not been calculated correctly. Maybe there was some air freight that wasn't brought in there. So that can be a big one. And buyers obviously are concerned there because, you know, they made an offer based on numbers. Whether it yeah. was intentional or not, they're going to get a little bit scared. Mm-hmm. So that's one where, you know, whatever it is, good or bad, you want to create a story around it, but you want to make sure it's accurate. And, you know, Fortunet mm-hmm. spends yeah, a yeah. lot of time doing the P&L we can do magic with the P&L, with ad backs for stockouts, all kinds of stuff that I think makes sense for sellers. You have other stuff around like IP. I've seen some deals fall apart because trademarks weren't registered correctly, and then buyers feel like they can't, you know, protect brand registry and things like that. Buyers look at things like review tactics, and if they find something that, you know, perhaps is gray hat or black hat, they might be concerned that, you know, they might get suspended or, you know, reviews taken away in the future. There's other things that, you know, happen, such as what we call a retrade, where even if everything looks great, some buyers unfortunately go into a situation and they just want to lock up a deal on an LOI, a letter of intent. And then once they get to the finish line, they want to maybe ask for an additional discount. Seen stuff like that happen. Sometimes there's reasons for it because the P&L, the profit was less than expected or whatever. But, you know, other times people are looking for good deals. I think at the same time, you probably have some sellers that go in and say, hey, we've been a month in due diligence. My business has grown even faster than I expected. And maybe they want to get a little extra money too. So I think it's maybe both sides happen with, but those are things that can kind of trip things up that I've seen before. So I think it's stuff you need to watch out for as a seller, and buyers are watching out for those as well.
That is great, because we have the combination of these two sides when you do have a chance to communicate, to analyze, to understand the numbers, and then to get the final like goal that you want as the acquirer or the seller. And that is perfect. And what will be the main three points as like the recommendations for people that right now preparing to be purchased? What will it be?
Yeah, sure. You know, I think first of all, maybe this is a little less of a point, but it's, you know, it is a very personal decision. I think it's not just financial. You know, it's a combination of your personal interests and financial. A lot of these businesses are growing super fast, so it can be hard to decide when is the best time. I think timing is important. There's a lot of times I had a seller recently that came to me and said, hey, I want to sell, you know, as soon as possible. I have another brand. I'm just too busy with this one, even though that brand's super attractive. And we actually said, hey, looking at your P&L the last 12 months, you know, you've grown so fast that if you just wait 3 or 4 months until you get that last March, April, May, the low numbers, because it was so new, if you wait a few months to make sure that the P&L is adjusted and, you know, you get maximum value there, you could get way more money. So we'll, you know, we're not going to say, hey, sell now, because, you know, we want to do the deals quicker. It's more about, you know, looking and saying, hey, how do you time it best personally as well as from a business standpoint, so you capture a maximum 12-month profit?
It's some kind of like the fear of missing out, something like that, that we see at Amazon sellers, something like that.
I think there's a lot of that. Yeah, for sure. I also tell people, you know, maybe don't focus. There's a huge focus on multiples, you know, everybody wanting to kind of, that's, I think when you talk FOMO, everybody wants to get the top multiple in their mastermind group or whatever. If I say somebody's looking at an exit in 12 or 18 months, maybe think about a number goal, you know, hey, I want to get 5 million. Because the multiple is really just a function of multiple times a profit. And there's so many things you can do to manipulate the profit and how you look at that. So, you know, that's a little bit more of just personal advice, I think, where, you know, you want to think, hey, what do I want to achieve in terms of an actual number value? And then there's a lot of the other stuff that's more practical, like, you know, make sure that you're not overspending on PPC. You know, make sure you're optimizing for profitability and perhaps not for growth of the products, because, you know, you're getting paid for profit, not for sales. That's a big one.
Jake, I guess that is a great time to speak more about you personally, because you have a great story, and I really like your approach as the freelancer for the next 8 years, right?
Yeah. So I was working I had a small little boutique agency. It was I always called it like freelancer on steroids, using VAs to help me basically extend myself. And I started doing that, you know, something like 8 years ago. I had moved to Argentina, just was kind of messing around for a few months and started working online. And, you know, the idea of a digital nomad was kind of early then, you know, you had people like Tim Ferriss that were talking about it. So I started doing that, you know, and it was like, I loved the freedom of it. I loved being my own boss, you know, visited maybe 60 plus countries at this point, all continents except for Antarctica, hoping to get to soon. But yeah, so I've been, you know, professionally that kind of enabled my lifestyle. I like the way the Europeans think that it's, you know, work to live, not live to work, even though I love, you know, I love business and I'm a capitalist and love making money. But, you know, so I was working as this digital nomad and, you know, traveling over the world and, it's been amazing. I'm super fortunate. I think to have discovered that and the world's gotten a lot easier.
Yeah, that is absolutely cool because right now we just see the situation when a lot of our like Profit Whales members, they just go like as a freelancers in the case of like the COVID situation, yeah? And they just do not have a chance to visit the office or work together as we previously done. So that I really appreciate this lifestyle in the case of the traveling because you got a chance to catch a lot of things, to improve yourself, to figure out your time management. I guess it's like one of the main things because you do have a control with all your tasks, with all your time. And that is amazing, I guess. Yeah, I really like that. So according to that, what is your main hobbies that you have? Traveling, I guess, is like one of it.
Yeah, traveling, I feel like it's so broad that it kind of is tough to, and when I'm working and traveling, you know, sometimes I don't get to do all the cool stuff I want to because I'm stuck in an Airbnb like I am right now in Rio. So I've been trying to do like actually real vacations. I'll go to like Cape Town for a week, don't work at all, do things like hiking. I've been getting into like kite surfing and sailing. End goal in a few years is try to sail around the world.
Whoa.
Need to practice a little
Whoa,
bit more.
Yeah.
Need to practice a little bit more and buy a boat and all that. But I'm thinking maybe like 3-5 years, you know. I'm kind of, I need to practice more and I need more time. So,
and you need a team, you know, you need a team of the guys.
I need a team. I have a few people that I think would join for sure. But yeah, I love anything with like high energy, high, you know, velocity and speed. I love riding motorcycles as well. So, you know, I love those risky activities.
That is cool. And could you please recommend to our audience the any books or any podcast that you like or you have just read like soon? Yeah.
Yeah, sure. For like e-commerce stuff, I'm a really big fan of Ezra Firestone. Probably a lot of people familiar with him. I think like I love the holistic approach that he takes. He talks about Amazon, but you know, everything direct to commerce, email marketing, all those things. So I think for e-commerce stuff, I'm a big fan of Ezra and the way that he talks and explains things and his philosophy. You know, personally, I love stuff like Joe Rogan. You know, I love that his just for fun to watch. You know, Tim Ferriss, when you talk about things like being a digital nomad and how to go out and start, you know, working remotely and balance your time and, you know, kind of personal fitness and stuff like that. I'm into as well. So those are some of my favorite things. And I'm always like, I guess I'm in a unique position where I get to talk to so many sellers and learn about their businesses, but so much of what I learned from e-commerce is just directly from the source, people that are doing it. Yeah. So I always say, try to tap into, you know, your own network of other sellers and see what they're doing. I love that about the FBA ecosystem is the masterminds, you know,
whether it's absolutely groups,
big ones or 5-person ones, you know, that's where I think the real magic happens.
Yeah, it's so cool to share this experience and a lot of Amazon sellers, they would like to help each other. And that is so cool.
Yeah.
When you have a like 1 month of experience or like a 5 years, they absolutely will be easy to speak or to communicate. And yeah, that is amazing. And according to the Amazon trends, what do you think will be next in 2021?
Yeah, well, I think that Amazon's going to kind of keep making it a little bit more difficult for sellers. That's, I think, what, you know, fees are increasing, IPI, inbounding, all these different things. I think the general trend is It's getting harder. Everybody who owns a business knows this. It's not only super competitive, but you know, you have these issues with Amazon. Mm-hmm. So I think that it's going to keep getting harder and harder. You're going to get more competition from the likes of aggregators, or what I call the homegrown aggregators, people that just launched multiple mm-hmm. brands themselves without acquiring. So I think things are going to just get a little bit more difficult, and it's going to be, you know, harder in some ways, but value is still going to be there. There's going to be tons of growth. But you need to, you know, it's not the 4-hour work week anymore. I think everybody watching that knows.
Yeah, that is true. I really like that. And the last question for today, who should be the next guest for the Dr. Amazon podcast?
Yeah, good idea. Good question. You know, I would recommend somebody like maybe Yael, who's one of the partners at Fortunet. Like, she talks a lot about e-commerce law and that part of it she can get really deep into. You know, I have a bunch of like friends and clients that are sellers that I'd love to recommend. I don't ask them first before before shouting their name out, but I know a couple guys that have just been so successful, and I love what they're doing, and they're getting ready to sell, and they're going to really kill it. So maybe I can hook you up with one of them.
Yeah, that would be amazing.
That'd be really cool.
We really these life stories, you know, when the people was on these on this situation, and they have a really cool things to share, as you have done today. Because I really like the idea on how you understand how both these sites works, how to collaborate with that, and how to get exactly what you need, and how to achieve like these goals when you exceed from the Amazon business or from the FBA business. It doesn't matter. So Jake, thank you so much.
The sellers are the real like heroes here, you know.
Yeah,
you guys you're building something that everybody wants. So I think I love those stories.
Yeah, and we for right now we got and more companies that want you. Yeah, and find in your phone to try to be calm, and everything will be perfect. So Jake, thank you so much for sharing all this information. That was amazing, and it was nice to meet you too.
Super fun. Thanks for having me. I love this kind of conversation, and I love what you're doing as well.
Yeah, thank you so much, Jake.
And that is all for today's Dr. Amazon episode. Do not miss our future arrivals with the new hot topics. Press the like button, leave us a comment below, and don't forget to subscribe. We will come back to you shortly.